It's getting recorded, right?
Yes. Yeah.
So our first question is like to lowercase. We have to implement a function lowercase that has a string parameter str, and it will return the same string but in lowercase. So this is like whichever character you find, it's not in lower, convert it. So here everything other than h, everything is lowercase. So entire thing is lower, and again it's same. Here also they have converted. Yeah, so how do you approach like?
So you can basically, if it is a uppercase character, then just change the ASCII value by adding 32. Otherwise leave it as it is. Can you see my editor?
Yeah, okay.
So I actually just did it. So basically, let's say we have this guy, right? I mean, hello, or we may have H-E-L-O, something like this, or we may have H-E-L, and then some other thing is like this. So this should give us hello. It's only the first is impacted. This will also H-E-1-L-O. And then this should give us H-E-L.
You have to set up Google Classroom for me.
So, okay. So basically, that's the transformation, right? So what we do is, because the string is immutable, so we just take a string builder. We'll keep adding it. And at the end, we will return the final string. So first we can take like the difference, because in ASCII, 65 is A, and 97 is A. So we can see that if I want to convert a uppercase into, no, I think I may, maybe it's the other way around. What is the ASCII for? It's 65 capital?
Opposite you have written.
That makes sense. Thank you. So, yeah, so we can see that if I want to convert capital to lower, then I will have to make 65 to 97. So we can do that by adding 65 plus 32. If we add, that is 97. So there's this difference of, and that carries over for everything, right? Like for, if A starts with 65, then Z will be 65 plus 26, and same for this. So that's the range that we are looking at. And there's 32 in the middle. So there's some extra characters from like the 27 to 31. But we don't need to worry about that. So there is no overlap in the range, and we just need to add 32 to the capital letter to make it lowercase. So we just keep that difference, whatever we need to add. We can also type 32. I just took a variable. And then we take each character of the string and we check whether it is falling in this range or not. So we could, here I just use the character representation. So if it is, if it is greater than A or less than Z, that means it is falling in the uppercase category, then we can basically add 32 to that character, which will make it lowercase. And then since result may be casted as an integer, we just convert that to the character representation. So 65, I saw that when we add 65 plus 32 or A plus 32, it kind of casted as 97. So we just take it back as character and then we append it to our string buffer. So that's the lowercase that's get appended. Otherwise we just leave it untouched. Whatever we get, we just append it. And at the end, we just return the string. So that's pretty simple. Should run in O of n time. So this should run in O of n time, n being the number of characters in the string. And space is, space is also n because I'm constructing new string. So that's it, guys.
Yep. Looks the most efficient way to implement, right?
Yeah.
So I don't think we can do anything better than this. That's the best we can do. But in the solution, they also mentioned something, you know, can be done with a hash map, but that will be using extra space, right?
He's also map. Using that.
Hash map?
Yeah, they have actually given an example saying we could do with a hash map. And just, you know, map all the characters of the ones with caps to the lower.
Oh.
Yeah, but it is not that efficient. But they have given different approaches, right?
Yeah. So maybe we have something like a care to care map.
Right. Yeah.
And then
just they are representing different ways. So yeah, that is one thing which I
same thing. Very
different. Yeah.
Yeah. So maybe if that is the case, then the loop might change. Like if map dot contains s, then sb dot append map dot get s. Something like this.
Yeah.
Correct.
That's exactly what they are saying. Yeah, right.
Yeah. This will also be constant.
Constant, 26 only, no? 26 letters, right?
Yeah, and then we'll have to have some loop at the start to set it up. So we will have some loop like for I don't know if we can iterate over characters that way, but let's say we can say from 65 to 65 plus 32 is 65 plus 32 is 97, huh? Thank you. So that's
97?
No, so I'm trying to say capital letters. So 65 plus 32, what is 97? Yeah. No.
Alpha letter are only 26.
And yeah. So 65 plus.
I don't
26. Oh, we should add 26. Sorry, my bad. So this is basically 91. Yeah, 11 and 191. Yeah. So basically 65 to 91. We can say map dot put.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Map. Including this, right?
We can say I plus 32.
Wow.
Yeah. So basically, this will be lowercase a, right? This will be this will give me lowercase a, or uppercase, yeah, sorry.
Uppercase, that will be uppercase, yeah.
That is my key. And then I'm saying map that to the lowercase version. So this will be 97. And then I'm looping.
So will this go from, will this go till 90 or 91?
This will go till 91.
So 90 is actually capital Z.
Ah, okay, good.
It is 20. It's 65 including.
Yes, good, good. Yeah, my bad. 25, both inclusive, right? Yes.
Super, yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's the best thing to do, yeah. Good.
Okay, guys. Thank you. I'll stop chatting.
Thank you. Thanks.
Yeah, it's same as what Jagrut explained. Just I'm checking if it is an alphabet, and if your order is less than 97, that means it's in a caps one. So just to convert it to lower, I'm doing this and just. Otherwise, if you find any special character, just keep on passing it. I mean, skip it at last return. Eh? I mean, just append that character directly to the, what you say, the empty string, whatever you have.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, order of pen only.
Yep.
Then tab.
Yeah, that's good.
Oh, yeah, we can switch to next.
Yep. Sure.
Yeah. So like merge intervals is there. We are given some collection of intervals and we need to merge all the overlapping ones. So if we look at this, so 1, 3 and 2, 6. So this, if you see, these three will come in this 2, 6. So 1 and 6, they have taken directly. And 8 and 10, so like 8 and 10 and 15.
Guys,
hello. Yeah, I think everyone got kicked off, right? Or
yeah, looks like, yeah.
Okay, no problem. There's some problem with the Zoom. Yeah, okay, so
looks like his Zoom got crashed.
Okay, maybe because of that. Yeah, so we can continue till he comes back, right?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, so Rajendra is the host. So, okay, let me see if I can share my screen. At least let's talk about the problem statement. Okay, so what he was discussing is we are given a collection of intervals and we have to merge all the overlapping intervals, right? So in this example, the first is trying to explain, like if you have these four intervals, then we merge the overlapping ones, like your 1 and 3 and 2 and 6 can be merge because they're overlapping. So the first will be 1.6 and the rest of the two will remain same. And in the second example, both of them, 1 and 4, 4, 5 actually can merge because they are overlapping, because even the end and start are the same, then it means it's overlapping and therefore we can merge them to 1 and 4. Right, so that is the only thing. So any approaches or any constraints or anything which is not clear in the problem statement? Hello?
Yes, yeah.
You can hear me, right? I thought I was also.
Yeah, I can hear you. So okay. I don't know about others, but I can hear you.
Okay. So I think for this merge intervals and the interval problem, the way Roger took his first session on that, I still remember that. And it looks slightly okay now, looking at this problem to be much not so difficult to understand, right? Because if we sort any time for such a problem, if you want to merge some intervals, if we sort it based on the start index, the start interval, right? And yeah, and just keep on comparing the next one every time. So you can actually get the, you can find which is overlapping, right? And if it's overlapping, the most simplest thing what you have to do is just find what is the maximum of the start of the two intervals and minimum of the end of the two intervals, and then just add that as a combined one, something like that, right? So I think the first one is already sorted. So in this case, if I see, like if I compare 1 and 3 and 2 and 6, they are overlapping because the start interval of the second, which is 2, is lesser than the end of the first one, right? So therefore they are overlapping. And if I actually go and see, take the minimum of both of these, like the both of the start ones, right? So 1 and 2, the minimum is 1. So I can add that over here. And then if I take the maximum of these two, the maximum of the end indexes and intervals, that is 3 and 6, and just add that, that becomes a merged interval for that, those two intervals which are overlap, right? Yeah, so do you have some different thing other than this or a better solution? Because we have to sort this over here. If there are anything which we can do without sorting, any approaches, if anyone can think of. Because I saw in one of the solutions, they said, you know, you can do the graph traversal. You know, you can find all the connected ones. You know, all intervals actually will act like a vertex, you know, and then we can find if each vertex actually is connected. So each interval is connected with each other. So the connection will be based on the merging. If they are merging, then we form a sort of a group, maybe like an island or so. And then for all of them, we can find the best, the minimum, maximum.
That sounds interesting to me.
Yeah, but the time complexity, space complexity is huge.
Could be, but I mean, thinking the problem in that way itself, interesting.
Yeah. So that was one approach other than this. And so this wins because the time complexity here is just n log n, and there it goes to n square, they say, because we have to go for each and every vertex and then we go for each and every edge, right? So that becomes n square. Yeah. So also in this one, actually, whenever we see if there are many such things which are overlapping, we need to even take care of that, right? So if you have a bigger one, like if the first one was 1 to 12, you know, so yeah. Then we have to merge all of them. So that is one actually critical way of thinking. Oh, sorry. Is he back?
No.
Okay.
And thus, do you mind to actually share that approach, the graph approach you just explained?
Okay.
Santosh?
Yeah.
So you need to find the max and min of every connected component, right?
Yeah. So therefore, you'll have to go through each and everything. So you'll have to go through the adjacency list of that particular vertex, right?
Yeah, so basically you need to create the whole list of the connected components, and then in every list of the connected component, you need to find the maximum, if I'm not wrong.
Right, the maximum minimum. So take all the start indexes and then keep on looking for whichever is the maximum in that. And for the end indexes, keep on looking for which is the minimum. And then you find one which is... But anyway, here also we do the same thing, right? If we have all the sorted, so if we have many components which are connect, which are overlapping, and then we try to do the same thing, right? We have to go through each and every interval and find out.
The difference is that we sort that, and then we just need to actually verify, check against the neighbor only.
Yeah, but if in the case, instead of the first example, the first interval, the end interval was, say, like 12, you know, so that will be compared with 2, 6 and 8, 10, right? So every time
in that case, you will merge the next neighbor and make it a combined single, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what you are doing here. But right. In case of graph, if I understand correctly, so you're saying that, I mean, for each node, you have to check it against other available node, right?
Yeah. Actually, we form a sort of whatever the traversal we take, right, in that. Okay, so whenever we are traversing, at that time we can find which is the minimum maximum for those two ones, right? We don't have to come back again. So if it's a BFS, okay, so we are at a level, okay, we take the root one, okay, that is our starting point. Then we go to the next level. And for whatever the ones which we encounter on the at that level, we just compare them with the one what we have. And then we keep on modifying our current interval which we think which we are merging for. So I think that is not a big thing though, but actually creating the graph, building all the components, that will be more, right? I can show you in the solution what they have shown here. So they're saying about connected components, if you can draw a graph with intervals on node that contains undirected edges. So this way, like if you have 1, 5, 4, 7, 6, 10, you know, these are the three ones which are connected and these two. So actually we can traverse the graph, right? So we can take this and say, okay, 1, 5 is the first one. Then we go, if it's like a this way, 3 level, okay. So we come to 4, 7. In that we find like, okay, 1, 5 and 4, 7, here we have to deal with only these two, right? So here we can say, okay, this will be maximum, right? So this will be 4, 5. The minimum, no? Okay.
Oh, but should be, let's say, minimum,
right? So it'll be 1, 7 here, right? So when we have 1, 7 here, okay. So 1, 7, and then we go with 1, 7 and 6, 10. So this will be 110, something like that. So at every time, we just have to compare two intervals, in this connected component server, right?
Why two only?
So see, okay, if I go
let's say if we enter 1 5 and then next interval is 6 10, so they are not connected. But so when 4 7 will come, it will connect both.
Okay, so when we are actually how do we do if you go via the BFS one, right? So okay, this is my route, what I'm entering through. Okay,
yeah.
Visitor one. Okay, so I have 1 5 here. Mm-hmm. So I go and the next level I find 4 7. Okay, because it has to be connected, then only I can find it, right?
No, but if it's if your input is next interval is 6 10, not 4 7, because your intervals are not sorted.
Yeah, it's not sorted. That's fine. Even if it's not, that's not a problem, right? So if you find this, then it means it has a connection. So why I'm saying that, because we have to build a graph first like this, you know, we have to build a graph so we can find the connected ones, right?
Yeah. So the building that graph will take time.
Yeah. Yeah. That is more than actually finding the minimum and maximum. So if you see,
how do we build that graph? Yeah.
So this is the way we do it. We just look at if they are overlapping, you know.
Okay.
If two intervals are overlapping, you just build a sort of adjacency matrix. So for this particular interval, we are just adding the intervals which are overlapped. So the way we do it, like if you have an undirected edge, right? So the same way he's adding it here. So we just create adjacency matrix of intervals, right? Yeah. So first we have to do that. This is just a very generic adjacency matrix. Only we are having intervals here.
Yeah. So that is the n square time.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that is what. And then before merging, it will be very simple that way. You know, just going for min and max for each and every one, right?
Yes. Yeah. After that, I mean.
Yeah. So then you actually, they are doing a DFS way. So you just do a DFS, but using a stack and just adding to the stack, right?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
So it's, I mean, for me now, for me, as soon as I see these interval problems, so immediately the sorting comes in my mind.
Absolutely. So that is what they say. This is the efficient way of doing it, but they just explained one approach and I thought that maybe this is your way of thinking, you know, like when you see even the time complexity, when he says n square, the way actually is breaking down is O of V plus V. Okay. So O of V and O of E, where O of V is n in this case, but O of E is n square. And therefore, because in the worst case, all intervals are mutually overlapping, right? So therefore n square. And therefore traversing the graph has the same cost. So actually it's slightly expensive here. And also the space complexity is more if we have all every other interval overlapping with each and every one. So that will be still n square. So therefore the sorting one, what we did here actually is n log n, right? And we just traverse it. Once we do a sorting, we just traverse it in O of n to find what the intervals are.
I have one more idea.
Uh-huh.
Instead of sorting, I think all we need is just a heap, a min heap, based on the first of the pairs. So any interval will have two items, right? Start and end.
Uh-huh.
If we create a heap, a min heap, based on the start,
uh-huh.
So then if we are given the whole array and we just call the heapify, then it will be amortized order of n. The heap will be ready. Then every time we pull it out, okay, it will be order of n log n because we'll be pulling one after another. So you just pull first one. And because it is a heap we are pulling from, it is guaranteed to be the starting value is guaranteed to be minimum of everything. So it is like we are traversing all the intervals. If the intervals are time ordered, then we are traversing from the left to right
in that order. I mean, that is the visualization I have right now. Mm-hmm. So suppose I have one interval already, mm-hmm. and then I see what is in the top of the heap. If the beginning of the entry in top of the heap is less than or equals to the one that I popped already, that means I have a merged interval. So I pop that out, I create a merged interval. Basically what I say is that, okay, instead of the whatever interval, probably if you could just show one of the examples. Yeah.
How that will be different than the sorting, Rajinder?
I think he's saying the same thing,
it's the same thing, because hippifying is a different approach.
He said that earlier.
Yes, it is n log n only.
N log n.
But yeah. What I'm saying is the order in which, so the heap kind of takes away, because of the constraints, it takes away the feeling that I am handling with a random, randomly accessible data structure. It only shows me the tip, only one thing. That takes away all the cognitive burden. So what I have is, I have one element which I have already popped, and the second one which is at the top of the heap, only two things. And that is where the merge will happen, nowhere else it will happen. And if the merge have to happen, then I will just merge that and keep it until I cannot merge it anymore. Then I push it to the output array. You're getting what I'm, are you able to follow?
Yeah.
So that way it is kind of forcing, the algorithm automatically takes shape because of the constraints of the heap. If I just think everything about my access to the random array, then the things become, there are quite a lot of things to consider that to me, that adds to the cognitive burden. If I just think of it as a heap, I cannot do anything other than just the tip of the element here. And I have just one more element to compare against two, or if required merge two, then it is very simple. It is just like, okay, until the heap is empty, you keep doing this. And what is this? This is basically check these two intervals, the one that I have and the other one at the top of the heap. If they're mergeable, merge it. If they're not mergeable, throw it to the output array and the new one comes and sits here. So,
okay. So first you will pop one of the element from the heap.
Yes.
And then it, you look for the top element and see if they are mergeable. If they are mergeable, you merge it.
Yes.
And just continue with the heap again.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
So only I'm at any given point of time, I'm only dealing with two intervals, and the heap property is basically taking care of everything. It is just kind of a machine which gives me the next best one to work with.
Yeah. Yeah, so.
No, we can use stack also, right? Or if we sort. In your approach, did you sort it before with the heap?
No, he's not sorting actually when he's using a heap.
Because it is not needed.
It's not required, right? So we just push any element. If it's a min heap, and then keep on actually popping it after that.
Yeah, the return itself is sorted.
Yeah.
Yeah, heapify is doing that, is sorting only, no?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, actually this min heap is actually sorting my all the intervals, right?
Yeah. Hmm.
So I mean like the sort function and the heapify is doing the same thing for this here, the input for us.
Exactly, taking first element of the each interval.
Yes,
so what will be the property of the heap? The min, what will be the min criteria?
The start index, actually. The start interval.
Based on that is heapifying, yeah.
Yeah, so based on the
start interval. Equal, then the second value will take. If the start is equal, then the second value will take.
Oh, I see. Correct.
Sorry?
Yeah. So he's saying that if both the start intervals are the same, so then what will be the next? So you'll look at the end interval, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That makes sense.
If both the start intervals are the same.
Yeah, if the start is same, then if which one has the end minimum, that should come first.
Yeah. Yeah, that we can actually specify in the min heaps comparator, right?
Comparator function.
I'm thinking even if we don't, suppose 1.6 came before 1.3.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, 1.6 and 1.3 need to be merged because the 1 of 1.3 is obviously less than 6. Mm-hmm. So that will get merged. And it will be okay.
Yeah, it will be fine. Yeah, that's true. But yeah, to be more better, you know, and more efficient. So we would like to have that condition also. Maybe. Yeah. Yeah, so actually, very simple thing, this is a very simple implementation, what I actually got from when I attended the Roger session, and I'm following this because it is very easy and it has become a very common pattern for me because most of the interval problems can be solved by this one, right? So exactly. So the way he did, for at least for the merge one is we first sort it, and then when we sort it, we push the first interval into our resultant output, right? So just keep on comparing, like if there is an overlap. So take that whatever has been pushed in that array, you know, and look for its end. If that end is greater than or equal to the start of the next interval. And just this is another condition to compare with if it's the start of the one which is already in the resultant, actually, it should be less than or equal to the start of this next interval. Then we can say it's an overlapping condition. And then we just do this max of the one which is inside the resultant and the current one, right? That's all. Or else we just push in all the intervals and at the end just return it. So yeah, I found this very easy to follow, but what Rajendra also came up with is a good one to think of in case if we are able to get that. Yeah.
Can you please explain from 9:15?
Santosh, looks like, I mean, you don't need that the end condition at all.
Right. You don't need this one, right? This one you're saying, right?
Yeah, as you already sorted.
Yeah, and this is not required. But this is the main thing. So, yeah, Ankur, right? So, Ankur, what I'm trying to do is I have already pushed one of the first interval inside my RES, the resultant vector. You know, and then I just look for the last element, whichever was in my vector. I compare its end index, with the start of the next interval. And then if it is greater than or equal to, I say it is overlapping, and then I actually just modify this. That's all.
Okay, and then else part? If it is else, not merging, then?
Then I just push whatever is there, you know. Yeah, whatever is the current interval which I'm iterating through, I just push in my resultant stack, a resultant vector.
Okay.
This looks very simple, no? Because
yes, very simple.
But it's always good to discuss different approaches, and I think Rajendra came up with a different one that was also good. Yeah.
So
I'm sorry.
Yeah. Sorry, I was looking somewhere else. So you were saying that the sorting condition, the start index, start time, we have already sorted. So we know that the interval that's coming later has a later start time. And then we were comparing the end of the interval. So we are, what was that criteria to see what
second is element of first element.
Yeah. So what I'm trying to do is whenever I actually, this part actually is clear, right? So first I actually just put in whatever is the one first interval into my resultant vector. And then what I do is I know at the top, whatever I have. Okay. So that is the one which has the least start interval, right? So I just compare the end interval of the one what I have in the resultant vector with the current interval start. So if this is greater than or equal to the start interval of the current interval, you know, so then we say it is an overlap. You know the overlap conditions, right? Or do you want me to draw that? I think Jaguru there.
Yeah, I just a quick refresher would be good.
Okay. So what actually is for? So if we have two intervals, right? Okay, let me check what my problem statement is. Okay, so if we have one interval like this, you know, this is 1 and 3, okay, and our second interval is like 2 and 6. So in this case, how do we find they are overlapping? So the end index, this is the end, okay, and this is a start, right? So the same thing for the start and this for end. So we have these two intervals. So this is interval 1 and this is interval 2. So how do we find they are overlapping? If we look at the end of one interval and compare the start of the other interval. So if the end of one interval, if this is greater than the start of this interval, so it means it is like this, right? So our second, if I just compare, okay, if I just take my line over here, you know, so this is my first interval, which starts at 1 and 3. This is my first interval. And then if I just look at my second, it will be 2 and 6, right? So this is my second interval. So the second start is actually lesser than the end of the first one, right? So this equation, actually, if I this formula, or if I say start of 2 is less than or equal to end of 1, right? So then it is an overlap condition, and then I can merge that. So when I'm merging it, what I do is I take the minimum of these two, minimum of the two starts and maximum of the two. So, but as I'm already sorting, so one will always be the minimum. So that is already there. So I just have to look for the two ends which are maximum. You know? So this is my current, and this is the one which is already in the race.
I think one more condition should be there, like second start should be greater than the first start. Otherwise,
no, but that will be satisfied as his input is already sorted.
Because we are sorting it, right? So that is really not
required. Okay. Yeah, that will take it.
Yeah. So is this clear, or you're still not clear, Jaguru?
No. I'm clear. So that means that S1, if our start of the second interval is mm-hmm. less than the end of the first interval,
right,
then our overlap interval will be start of 1 till end
of the first second, yeah,
end of the max of these two.
Max, right?
Yeah. So usually how we do when they are overlapping, you know, we just say minimum of start of both, okay, and maximum of end of both, right? So that is the general formula. But as here we have all intervals sorted, so we don't have to look for the start, you know. So we just look for the end ones, and if we see whichever is maximum, then we actually modify that value.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Very good. Thank you so much.
Yeah, Shashank.
So we can proceed to third then. So it's like maximum nesting depth of two VPA valid parenthesis strings. So a string will be a valid one, valid parenthesis, if it's an empty, if and only if it consists of open and closed braces, parenthesis. Apart from that, it should be an empty string, and it can be written as AB, A is concatenated with B, where both A and B should be a valid one. And you can write it like this, where A should be a valid because closed and open are already valid. So the mid one should be valid. And regarding, So they have given like, and how do you define the depth of any valid parenthesis? If it is an empty, then it's zero. And depth of A plus B will be max of these two, depth A and depth B, where both A and B will be your valid ones. And coming to here, depth of this, what is it? Open plus A should be valid, and this close is equal to 1 plus depth of A. 1 comes because of this open one, and whatever will be the depth of this that you have to include. So if you can see here, this is an empty, so it is 0. And for this, it's starting with 1, so first depth. But since it is closed by, it's closed. So only one opening is there here, and again it is closed. So it's 1 till now. It got cancelled. Again, if you start from here, it is 1. And again, it got closed. So depth is 1. So till here, the depth is 1. But if you switch to these two, the depth of one opening is there. And again, second opening is there. So it is having a depth of 2. And so you need to, yeah.
Yeah, coming back to that, you know, what you were just showing here, for example, here. So when it is blank, so when it is empty, the depth is 0, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And when you have just the second example, just two parentheses, which are concurrent to each other, and they don't have anything nested inside it, so the depth is 1,
exactly.
Right?
1, yeah.
And in the second example, third example, when you have one parenthesis close open, and then you have a nested one inside, the second one, so because so the depth is 2. The max depth of this example is 2, right?
So
as per this, these are the only VPS that we are going to encounter in our problem, right?
It could be more nesting, like 3-4 inside, but structure will be same. It will be like this only.
Okay, so you would have more than this?
Yes
can't we have one more nesting like this? We can have one more nesting inside, like one level 2, and again one more nesting inside the second.
Okay, let's go. Sorry to stop you there. Yeah, no problem. Because I am not very clear about it, therefore I was asking you here.
Okay, I think it should be like.
Okay, no problem.
We'll be given a VPS, and we need to split it to two disjoint subsequences A and B, such that the length of, the first length plus second length should be equal to the entire sequence length. And just now choose any A and B such that max of depth A and depth B is the minimum possible value, and return the answer array that encodes each of the choices A and B. Answer of I equal to 0 if sequence of I is a part of A, else will be 1. Note that that even though multiple answer may exist, you may return any one of them. Okay. So coming to this, if we see, so first it will open, right? A, let's say, okay, I think we can give it in a diagram. So it's like this, right?
Yeah.
And this.
One and the close. Okay.
If this is A, this is B, then I have opened A. Now, this is your A. Now coming, I shouldn't use B this. I shouldn't give it to A, because if I give it to A, the depth of A will increase. So we have to keep the minimum of depth. So let's give it to B. So B will take this. Now coming to this, you can give to anyone, A or B. It will be balanced. So if I give to here, so it will be your A. And again, this will come. B, you shouldn't give it to B, because if you give it to B, again, the maximum depth will be 2. We have to minimize the depth. So let's give it to A. So it will go to A's. And this is again, you can use it for A or B. So this is like this, and this can again be used for B because it is your open. So just close it. So your encoding is like, if A is 0, then it should be 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. And it could be anything, like it's one of the possible answer. I mean, mine is not matching with them. So it could be any of the possible ones.
So wherever B, you are saying that would be 1.
Yeah, B, I'm taking 1, or vice versa. Like,
Yeah.
Right. Let's Yeah.
I have one greedy approach. Can I share that?
Yeah, sure. If you can, we discuss second. Okay, share it.
Yeah, actually, yeah, let's discuss some of the problems because, you know, they are more critical. Yeah, absolutely. The implementation is also not so easy. But I was not able to get actually the problem statement and it was not so clear to me. I don't know what
the problem statement is like saying is that we have to divide into such a way like maximum depth should be minimum for both A and B.
Yeah, yeah. Like,
yeah, so what is that actually when you say maximum depth should be minimum? So
like what that means that suppose that if there is the string is given, we will choose some indices. Like suppose in this you can see that that he's drawn here. Suppose
like if A B, right, I'll tell you, like let's say if we start from here, it's an open. So here the depth between A and B is what? One, right? I mean, A is having one bracket and B is having zero. Depth of B is zero and depth of A is one.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you face the second one, definitely you'll close it, no doubt at all. Because if you, because there is no opening, so you'll close it. Now, when you go to this, you can give either to A, either to, because now the depth of this is zero because we don't have opening one here and we don't have any opening over here. So you can give either to A or B. So if I give, let's say, if I'm giving it to A. Now, next when this comes, if I give it to A, the depth will become 2, right? Because 2 nestings will be there. So it's better to give it to B, because if I give it to B, the depth will be 1 only, right?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So yeah, so right. The depth is increasing. Depth will increase if I open a bracket and it will decrease if I close the bracket.
Yeah, because if you give this bracket to this, the depth of, I mean, they are telling you have to minimize the max depth of A and B. So max depth is 2. And here it will be 1. If you minimize, you can't, I mean, you have to minimize the depth of A and B both. So it's better to give, initially it was having 0. So if we give this bracket to this one, so the depth of this will be reduced to 1. So this will be the minimum. So otherwise it will have a depth of 2, A will have 2 and B will have a depth of 0. So next when you hit this, you can use it either for A or B. So it will cancel. Again, the depth will be 0. Now when you open, you can't give it to B because if you give it to B, this will become 2 and this you have 0. So it's better to make it 1-1 both so that it will be balanced. I mean it will be minimum 1. So let's give it to this and this one you can give to close anyone. So whatever encodings you have.
So at the end, then A and B both will become 0, right?
Yeah, at the end both will become 0 because it's the VPS, like balance.
Balanced string, we have to minimize the maximum depth in both the subsequences.
So even what?
So also the sequence 0, 1, 1 and all that may not be same, right?
Yeah, that will not be. So that depends on how you are taking. Like if I give first 1 to B, first bracket, so that time the depends how you do the encoding. Could be one of the possible answers, whatever they have mentioned, but it could be different what you are saying.
Okay.
What is the 0, 1, all these things? What is the numbers in output denote? Because I understand
number it is like A will be given 1. You have to encode it, A and B.
So it's like two sets, A and B.
It is grouping.
So A 0 is in set A and 1 is in set B. So we are actually dividing the whole input into sets. And that is what the output is representing, right, Shashank?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Because earlier I was thinking, you know, we should actually have output of depths. But now when you are actually showing it, it means it's just we are representing the sets, A and B.
Sets.
Okay.
So because if depth output will be checking, that because it is valid parenthesis, valid string parenthesis, so that will always be zero, right? A and B will like depth will eventually get zero and then we just need to check what we assign to the brackets like A and B and then we code like suppose A we have taken as zero and B as one. So I think that we are writing in the output, right?
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. You're just encoding how you, whom you have given A, you are encoding it as zero and B as one.
Yeah, that's a good point. But if in case, if we have an unbalanced parenthesis, so what are we supposed to do?
It won't be, will it be? They have given a VPS. Oh, I mean, you're telling like worst case, right?
Right, yeah, because...
Maybe like we need to return something, another output zero or not possible. I'm not sure about that test case.
Yeah, they're
no,
not
but
mentioned.
A VPS, so yeah. Why have that?
Yeah, I think yeah, what they are saying is it will always be a VPS, right? A string is a valid parenthesis string at the very beginning. What he says, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Exactly.
So it's very confusing the statement, but just as a thought, like, is this a good approach? You just have two counters, A and B, and as soon as you see, as soon as you see an open one, you increment the counter whichever is least, and then whenever you want to decrement, you decrement the last counter that you had updated for either A or B.
And closing your tail.
Whenever you close it, so you have two counters A and B. And I'm just sharing my idea. So if you have two counters A and B, So if you have two counter A and B, this both start with zero, and I'm maintaining the output array, whatever I want to build. Now I see an open parenthesis. I will see what is the value of the two counters. Whichever is least, I will increment him. So let's say A is least. So I increment him, and then I assign the ID of A at that index in the output result. So he gets a zero. Now next time the open comes, A is one, B is zero. So B gets it. And then I assign the ID of B, which is one in my output array. Now then close comes. So I have an option to either close zero or one. Let's say by convention, I will say that whichever I last incremented, I will decrement him. So I will decrement B. So now B becomes zero. So, and B's ID goes in the, which is one. Now another open comes. So now at this point, A is one, B is zero. So I will assign him to B. And so basically keeping track of the counter and who was the last assigned one. So always take from the last assigned one. And always maintain this property that the difference should never go more than one. Will that work?
I think yes, I happened the same only.
So you're trying to say you'll have two counters, one for A and one for B, correct?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, before you can share.
That might be.
Can I share?
Because if you look at the problem statement, it seems to be like a stack problem, you know, using a stack, something
exactly.
Like that. Yeah, but it's not, right?
Actually, using the stack will probably help because how do we distinguish that when we see the closing parenthesis, we should match it with B, not with A, because we cannot match it with A. The last example that we saw right now, so A has already open parenthesis, B has already open parenthesis, but when the closed parenthesis came, even though both of them have the same depth, both of the counters have the same number, but we have to match it with B because last time B was opened. So that last time tracking, probably that will become easy with a stack rather than manually doing it. That is what my
thought. Like I implemented with the counters. I can show also that it's very easy to
That's fine. Ankur, you are saying is correct. But what Rajendra is saying is a point, and that's a good point too, right? Because stack, we are actually programmed to think such problems in a stack way, right? So that becomes very easy to understand. And what he's saying, yeah, because, but only thing is when you see a close parenthesis and you think it should go to B, I'm not sure whether actually that will work here because of the way these guys are describing, we have to give it to A always, you know, because if both point counters are same, so you give it to A first. That is what actually I understood what Shashank was saying, right?
Then that will not be a valid parenthesis, right? Because each element of a valid parenthesis string itself is valid parenthesis string. So think about this. If we have two open parentheses and one closed parenthesis, of course it is not valid parenthesis string, but when we are at the first closing parenthesis, it can only belong to B, not to A.
That's true, but what the way he was showing, it seems like we need to always satisfy A first to make it, if both of them are same, then first we need to give it to always to A. Maybe I did not understood properly that it means. Yeah, but it
no,
seems exactly. to be like that. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. That we can take to the same process or not, that we have two counters and we can count it's whichever is larger. Like if A is smaller, then we assign to A, and if B is larger, then assign to B.
Is it like that? Okay. Yeah, maybe.
But if like one. Both are larger, then to whom to assign? Like anyone or which one to pick? Yeah. That is, I think, we are discussing.
A.
Yeah.
A. And we can.
But as Rajendra says, it also makes sense, right? Why not use it to B? Because that is what we got last time, right? Because you stack will always do it that way, right?
Exactly. Because whatever top it will see, it will do that like that.
Mm. What I'm saying is, think about example one, which is, if somebody can present example one.
Ankur, share it. Like, yeah, so that, or should I say?
Yeah, I'm sharing.
Yeah, share a whiteboard first, because that is what he was trying to explain.
Okay.
I wanted the problem definition. That is where the sequence they have written already and the expected output they have written.
Okay, you want the example?
Okay, yeah, just go there, you know. And you just, okay.
Yes, the first one.
Mm-hmm.
So as you can, example one, as you can see, I don't think it will be acceptable solution to say 0, 1, 0. 0, 1 has, the 1 has to come after 0, 1. Otherwise, that is my guess. Can we just run this example with a simple output of 0, 1, 0 and keep everything else probably same? I'm pretty sure this is going to fail. No, you'll have to close it because otherwise it will not be a valid parenthesis. Yeah. And for this, what should be our output? Our output can be 0, 1, 1, 0. It cannot be 0, 1, 0, 1. That is what I'm saying.
Yes, you're right. Because I'm testing it.
Uh-huh, that's correct. I think what you're saying is...
Actually, these are subsequences, because we can we are picking one from here, and then this algorithm is picking one from here.
Yeah, that is what's confusing, you know, when you start running it, because you look at the example one, what Rajendra was explaining makes sense, but when you actually try to run it for a different example like this one, what he did, Ankur, so you see they don't match our logic of the stack.
Then it is as simple as just counters. Actually, what we understood was actually 0, 1, 1, 0 should be the answer and nothing else. But here probably they are not ensuring that.
I think that should also work, right?
Why not? It should work. What if Rajendra says that way also the output should work?
Yeah, that should also work.
Yeah.
No?
Yeah. In case if we program it that way, because right now it will get accepted. It will get accepted. Yeah.
But what I see here is this thing is very pretty much easy to implement because it is only two counters. You won't have that state to manage.
Yeah.
Okay. Where should I keep it? Is
yeah. Just, yeah.
Whatever
but,
is.
But it's not intuitive, you know, the way. Yeah. Yeah, it's not at all.
I looking at the problem definition, I can't understand that is what they are looking for.
Yeah.
Like they are missing something actually.
Yeah.
So for a stack, we have to use two stack, right? One A stack, another B stack. Or in single stack, we can do.
Yeah, actually, I think we'll have to use two stacks. And we'll have to, when the closing parenthesis comes, we'll have to see which of the two stacks have the higher value. That we'll have to close first. So in the stack, we'll be sending the index of, we'll be keeping the index of the open parenthesis. Okay. Mm-hmm. Right. So now the stack for A will, okay. I think you.
No, so, but in that case, if you have stack A and stack B in your example, Rajendra, so you will have both open parentheses for A and B. In that case, both of the sizes are same.
No, no.
So then how are you going to decide with the closing one, what cups are next?
Okay, let me describe. So I have stack A and stack B, both are empty. I first saw a open parenthesis. Whichever stack has a lower value, okay, I'll just keep it there. Both of them are equal, doesn't matter. Let us choose A, put it there. What are we putting? We are putting the index of the open parenthesis. Okay. So stack A right now have zero. Then comes another open parenthesis. Now the stack length of B is less than stack length of A. That's why B gets it. And B has the value one. A has the A stack's topmost value is zero. B stack's topmost value is one. Now closing parenthesis comes. Now it is easy. We know which one was the last stack used because whoever has the highest value at its top was the last used.
Okay, so you're looking for the indexes, yeah. Okay.
I'm not looking for the index. Stack means I'm only looking for the top and length anyway I have.
Right? Like Rajendra, what I understood that you are using the, we are using a counter and you're replacing it that with the stack length. So it is like same only, you know, that because you're replacing it with stack length. So that, no. That is taking.
So he's using indexes in the stack. He's just putting indexes of our.
No. Like before assigning the group, so he is comparing the length of the stack, na? Like if, to get the from which he has popped out.
That is similar to the counter, but because of stack, I am getting the extra signal, which stack was last used.
Okay, makes sense.
Can we run one example quickly? Because I was that 10101, shouldn't that be 0110, the one that we ran?
That is possible.
That is possible. It will also work. That output also it will accept. Yeah.
Yeah, any of the possible.
Because he has programmed it this way, therefore you're seeing this output. But they're expecting maybe anything, but whatever we are thinking on the lines what Rajendra is discussing, that is also an okay solution.
So like I think both the approaches are working. That means like we don't need to keep track of the last counter which we have used, or we can use any counter, no? To minimize the length, basically, to make it zero.
Yeah, I think that it doesn't matter whether you close A first or B first here, right?
Yeah, and like we can do that also, and we can keep that track also, which we like, in which one we have put the open parenthesis as last. So both approaches are working here. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, that is right.
Yeah, that depends. Yeah.
That's a correct assumption. Yeah.
No,
makes sense. Yeah. Same approach that we were discussing, that I took two variables, that is 80% A current depth and it is B current depth. So if I encounter that opening parenthesis, and if the A's current depth is less than or equal to B's current depth, then I'm assigning it to the A. I'm representing A as zero, A group. And I'm incrementing the current depth of A. And if I encounter the closing parenthesis, and if A current depth is greater than B current depth, so I have to decrease the current depth of A. Therefore, I assign it to A again. And same goes for B also. If A's current depth is greater than B current depth, then I will assign opening parenthesis to B, and then I will assign here one at this index. So this and this is also the same logic.
Well, yeah, looks good. Very simple. Yeah, he has actually explicitly made all the states.
Mentioned.
Yeah.
seems quite easy.
You could have,
right.
You could have
coming up some this stage is very difficult, just looking at the problem.
You could have used some complement stuff like 1 and 0 only you have to do, right? So 1 minus L, 1 minus 0 if you do, you'll get 1. And like red and blue, if you have to represent two colors, you can use 1 for red and 0 for this. So whenever you have to get color red, so 1 minus blue you do. Whenever you have to get blue, 1 minus red you can. That will optimize your
color. Yeah, that's a very optimized version. But for a layman actually like me, this is much easier to understand.
Yeah, exactly. No, this actually, is pretty intuitive. I saw it, I mean, many places like in graph and all, bipartite graph, all those places. So
actually, when I saw this question, I didn't understand what this question is saying. So I that looked various discussion forums that people have asked that what this question means. So then I saw one statement that we have to divide in the, such a way that we should be minimum of the depth should be there. So this came to my mind.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, it's intuitive one. So it would be order of n only, right? I mean, entire length you are parsing. You are parsing
order of n. Order of n.
Yeah.
Pretty cool. Understanding the problem itself will take more time.
Challenge.
Yeah, so you're using space. An extra space. No, it's not because that's the output. Yeah.
No, that's the output.
Yeah, it's just an output. Yeah. No problem.
Any doubt you're having? Yeah.
No, this is clear. Yeah.
Yeah.
If they would have said whether it valid or not, then at the end we can also check the counter. But in this case, no need.
Yeah, don't need it. Yeah.
So see everything is same. I just did this part extra. What I was explaining that red and blue binary value we can use. Whenever you have to use only binary values, you can use this type of approach. Like one left will be 1 minus right and right will be 1 minus left.
This is a very optimized version, right? Yeah.
I included 4 condition and he is done is 2 condition only.
Mm. Yeah, that's good.
So one article, go ahead.
In this, where are we tracking the which one is bigger?
Yeah, that's a good question. This is Python now. He'll come up with some good solution.
We are not tracking here, right? I think it will take care of. See, let's say this is your graph, right? Sorry, graph, no. So initially what you'll have in and this is your rest, let's say. So first is your open. Once you encounter the open, so L will be 1 minus L you are doing. So L will be what? 0, right? So you'll append 1 to it, right? Next time again you are hitting this, when you are hitting this, it will again append 1 to your, it will append 0 now.
0, yeah.
So this way, this is taking care of that.
Yeah.
Hmm.
So L and R complement will be
complement, one time exactly.
Will be B set or A set. That is what it is trying to do there. Hmm.
Implicitly, it is taking care inside.
So it's just toggling between two sets every time.
Yeah.
Oh man, this is tricky.
It's not like that trivial to come up, but it's good. Like if you know, I've seen this one in many of the problems using this toggle method, which minimizes a lot of lines of code.
Yeah. But in interview, I'll prefer if I come up with a solution, I'll prefer the way Ankur said.
Ankur, yeah, because that is
yeah, that's more easier. Because here, if I make a small change and it messes up, I'll be just stuck in that explaining my interviewer what is wrong and what is right. Yeah.
Basically, in this, if I see, they, we are maintaining two things in one state. One is the ID to append, and the counter. They are both collapsing into one.
ID in the sense?
ID means like the one that's going in the input array, like 0 and 1, 0 and 1. That is the same that I'm... L is basically serving the dual purpose.
So, yeah, L and R, both are actually complementing, and So, L just serves for open parenthesis and this one for close. Yeah.
Closed one, yeah.
Yeah. Something like that. Yeah. No problem.
Yeah, first time, let's say L is zero, then open comes, he will append zero. And then next time open comes, again L will be appended, but that time L is one.
One, yeah.
Yes, very nice.
Yeah. Okay.
Yep, cool. Thank you, Shashank. Yeah.
Thank you. So one last one, like how do you calculate the anagrams? Just 5 minutes here. I mean, if an anagram is given two words, how do you like go for it?
If an anagram is given, so if you have two strings, right? And that is what you're doing. Yeah. And then we have to find the anagram, whether one string is anagram of the other, right?
Yeah. One thing is like you can sort it and compare it, right?
You're going to frequency map, right? You just to maintain frequency map of one.
You can
early exit also if you see that anyone is not matching, then early exit. Otherwise, your full map will match.
And today I was going through an article in which they use for every character they have associated the prime numbers to it. Like let's say ARE and EAR, both are anagram, right? These two are anagrams, right? To A, they have given give prime numbers to all the three characters of this. So let's say 2 I'm giving, and 3 is a prime again, and 5. And same, whatever encodings I've done here, same you do here. R you can give 3, and A you can give 2, and E you can give 5. And if you find that the product of these two are same, these two, like here the product will be 30, right? And here again you'll have 30. So if these two products are same, then they are anagram.
Okay, that is good. Yeah, in case of Java, okay, because if we have a very big string, you know, in case of C++, it might overflow in any.
Then will you put there one LL, one long?
Yeah, but that's you are consuming more space, right?
That will consume more space.
And if what happens if it's a big sentence like about 100 character string, you know?
Then it is not possible.
Yeah, so it depends on, we need to ask how much big the string length is, right? For this thing. Yeah, this is a good approach though.
Because I thought, I mean, we are not using any map and all anything, sorting and all, simply product, doing the product and assigning prime numbers and doing the product.
Yeah, this is good. Yeah, absolutely.
For so smaller thing, it will work.
But it seems that if you take 26 length of the array, then it will be more easier that because that is more easy to think also, and then because here we are thinking product, so it is like I haven't seen this approach ever. It is like unique approach.
Yeah, therefore he's trying to come up with saying this is what he saw and wanted to share. Yeah, that's a good thing. Yeah, because whenever you come with such big numbers in C++, we can't handle for that overlapping, right? So we need to take care of that overflowing. You know, in Java you can actually handle, right? You can handle big numbers, and also Python.
Python you can handle. Yeah, might C++ there might be trouble.
Yeah.
So trouble like product will be bigger, right?
Yeah, if the product is bigger, you can't put that in. Yeah, it'll overflow. So you'll have to again keep some track for the overflow condition, you know, and then there will be some implementation details to be written for it, right?
Like basically, we will what we will do then we will they implement their is it three LL into we will typecast there then 1 1 1 LL and for 3 LL we will do that like that.
Yeah, actually that should be good. Yeah, you know? Actually,
this will not be a practical solution for any of the I would say production code. I would say because currently even each string can become length of thousands of bytes actually. So. Unless we have a big integer library to handle the multiplication and all, and in any way, if we go big, if we use a big library, then the complexity will be even more. The computation, number of computation will be more. So at the gist of it is basically we are coming up with a signature and we are saying if two signatures match, they are anagrams. That's all. How we are coming, this is just one of the signatures we are generating, which is the signature generation is associative basically. It doesn't matter in which order you compute, the final product is always the same. We are using that property of the operation to come up with this signature.
Yeah, but I think what he's trying to say, this product becomes easier to compare because you're just multiplying. In case of that, if you are having a frequency map, you'll have to go through each and every element and look for compare for each and every one, right?
That's why what people do is basically they sort it, mm-hmm. basically given a string, they sort it so that none of the vital, none of the individual signals are lost mm-hmm. and they're still there. So that becomes their signature. So any string, you just sort it.
But will sort not involve n log n for that?
Sort will involve, think about it. Mm-hmm. In the sort, that n log n, that n is one character. Here, we are multiplying that character. So multiplication is an operation which is probably way more than a count. How I'm saying is
yeah I got your point. So but the only thing when I was not comparing with this one for the sorting, I was comparing with the frequency map in that case, you know. So
when you're saying frequency map, what do you mean?
You know, like have an array of 26 indexes, assuming that all of these are, you know, lower or upper cases only, you know, and okay. that whenever we go through the string, we just increment that index value.
Index value. So you are keeping a map of something.
Yeah, we are keeping, like if we are having, assume that we have only lower cases to deal with. Uh-huh. So if we have an array of 26, uh-huh. you know. So if uh-huh. I encounter an A, so I will just increase my counter in one. Yeah, zero.
Probably that is So the difference between this approach and that is you are taking extra space.
Yeah,
you're trading with computation. That's all.
Yeah.
And this technique is used in many problems, that assigning prime numbers and getting the product, because it has a very unique property. Like you can't use even numbers for all these things.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. That's true. Yeah. You have to use prime. Yeah.
In the first prerequisite, it becomes to compute n prime numbers. Sub problem.
Yeah.
Yeah. But that we can use with C of erasness.
C of erasness.
Oh, yeah. So
instead of multiplying, what if we use just addition and also check for length of string?
Addition won't work, right?
Addition won't work.
Only multiplication might work. If you add two prime numbers, they will make some other number. But they won't be same in some cases, you know. I don't know, maybe Shashank might be able to throw some light.
No, I meant to say this ARF, right? Mm-hmm. ARE or F, ARE, right? What mm-hmm. if we do, instead of multiplying and make it 30, mm-hmm. if we just do addition and also check for the length of the string? So each character divided would be A to Z, which would be 26, right? And we just add them up and also check for the length.
Maybe we're trying it, but he has come up with some multiplication. So he might have actually looked into it somewhere.
I'm not able to recall the reason. But yeah, addition should also have worked, right? But I don't think so. Assign prime, maybe here prime numbers are there. That's why their product are same. But there could be some sequences in which you assign prime numbers and you add them. They might not come to be same. Product seems to be same, but it should, right? If it is.
Yeah, he is saying you just not only add, but add and check the length of the strings. Yeah. There might be something to check with it, right? Yeah.
In that case, maybe in C++, we may not face the overflow.
Right. Okay. Makes sense.
Shashank, that question that we were discussing yesterday, that last question.
Yeah.
We missed one thing that if they are collinear, then that case we missed like that, I think.
Those three points.
I saw one solution that if that I've posted in the group also,
I saw that. Mm-hmm.
So one thing I didn't understand in that solution very clearly, if we can discuss here.
Can you share?
Okay, I'm sharing.
Hey, can you stop the recording, Shashank? Because
I think Praveen has to stop because I lost it now. So Praveen is the host.
Okay, let me do that.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Yeah, now share.
Okay. This we were discussing yesterday.